going to be any. It is going to what you have already yesterday from Dr. Rake, right? The same thing I'm going to repeat, but the intention is not to waste your time, but to see you as really skilled in Lean Six Sigma methodology. And this is going to make a big difference. This is where most of the green belts, most of the black belts in the entire world, they struggle. They say, I'm a green belt, I'm a black belt. When you talk to them about hypothesis testing analysis, they will run away. When you talk to them that what is exactly Six Sigma, they will run away. But I'm sure you have already clearly understood what is the difference between a Six Sigma process and a Three Sigma process. Right? If you want to define what is Four Sigma, you will be able to define. Yeah, trust me, you can ask this question to a professional who is 10 years, 20 years experienced in industry. He will run away from you. Right? So you can really place yourself much, much better in front of anyone else if you learn all these modules very effectively. So we will understand what is hypothesis testing. And RK sir was saying about p-value. It's all about the error. P-value measures the error. What is that error? Right? And how much it is? Sampling risk and sampling error. There are two types of error. Type 1 error and type 2 error. P-value is all about type 1 error. We are going to understand that. And there is null hypothesis he was saying, alternate hypothesis he was saying. He was talking about alpha. Alpha is also known as level of significance. There are so many jargons. I can call all of you as, you know, as students of Wales University. I can call all of you as MBAs. I can call all of you as, you know, postgraduates. I can call you by your name, but all are same. Same way, there are so many terminologies. You should not be confused. You should understand them and then use whatever the jargon used by, you know, the industry. You should be able to understand immediately and then talk to them in the same language. And how to select the hypothesis testing. Yesterday itself, he taught you Z test. Yesterday itself, he taught you T test. He taught you one proportion test. He taught you two proportion test. And he is ready with another dozen of tests. I don't want you to learn everything from him. I want you to learn from him at least three or four hypothesis testing. And then in the future, in your project, a new hypothesis testing is required. Learn it at that moment in 5 minutes and then use it. That's all. You can't learn everything, you know, at a time, and then you can't have a ready-made solution for all the problem. In my opinion, there is no ready-made solution to any kind of problem. Any problem deserves analysis, preparation. Then only it can be solved, right? So no ready-made solution. So you cannot be fully prepared for any situation, but your foundation should be very strong, right? So if you understand what is hypothesis testing, one hypothesis testing, Dr. RK will be teaching you 10 hypothesis testing. You understand at least one, that is good enough. All nine can be learned whenever they are required. If that one also you don't understand, please understand, mistake is not with, you know, the person who is teaching you, the mistake is with you. You have not asked the right question during the session, right? Equip you properly. And this is what. So hypothesis testing is all about testing the difference. In my opinion, I am saying that students who are attending this session with their video on, and on the other side, students who are attending the session without keeping the video on, the end result is going to be different. Do you agree with my statement? The end result is going to be different. Those who are participative, those who are on video, their learnings are going to be much, much greater than others. Is this statement making a difference, making a sense? I am expecting a difference in the performance. Any statement when I make about the difference in the performance or difference between two individuals or difference between two groups, difference between two machines, difference between two population, difference between two samples, any statement that talks about difference is called an hypothesis. If you test that statement, that is called hypothesis testing, right? I hope all of you are familiar with this product, what you are seeing, Maggi packet, right? The Maggi, we all eat 2 minute noodles, right? From our childhood, we have been eating. You know what happened in 2015? 38,000 tons of the Maggi packets were simply burnt. Did you hear the news?
Quantity of arsenic, sir. Arsenic.
Yes, it is because of the lead content that is present in the Maggi. The lead content was found to be significantly higher. The word significant is important. If I have to reject you, I should have a significant reason. Otherwise, I cannot reject you, isn't it? You have applied for a job in my company and I want to reject you. I must definitely have a significant reason. See, this candidate marks are low. This candidate interview marks are low, and that is the reason I am rejecting him. This is important. Same way, when I say the Maggie packet is bad, there has to be a significant reason. That significant reason is the lead content. There is a prescribed level, Food Safety Authority, isn't it? FSSAI. They have certain regulations. Lead content should be so much. Can you tell me what kind of data the lead content is? Is it a continuous data or a discrete data?
Continuous
data. That lead content is found to be higher than the prescribed level. And so Maggie product was banned. Maggie was banned. 38,000 tons of Maggie packets there were in the retail market. Do you think the person who took the decision to ban Maggie has checked all the 38,000 ton product? No?
No.
You and me, even God cannot check. All that we can do is we can take a sample and take a quick decision. So a sample was taken from the market. A random sampling technique was used. Sampling technique has been taught to you, am I right? Dr. R.K. has taught you. Random sampling, systematic sampling, cluster sampling, stratified sampling, convenient sampling, and combination of all these techniques also possible. Ultimately, your sample should be able to correctly speak about the population. If you can make it make it happen with your sample, your sampling technique is the best. I cannot say this is the best sampling. No, you have to decide. Right? And then the lead content was more than the higher prescribed level. Lead content is a continuous data. What the food inspector could have done? How many samples he could have taken? He could have taken 5 sample, 10 sample, 20 sample, at the maximum 100 sample. Suppose imagine he has taken 100 sample. He will send all the 100 packets to a laboratory, and laboratory will test and then give the lead content result. What will he do with all the lead content value? 100 reading?
Statistics.
He could have calculated the average. He could have calculated the average. Am I right? The average lead content is going to represent all 100 samples. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Sample is correct. This average can also represent the population average. What is population? The 38,000 tons in the market. You get my point? Sample average, if selected correctly, without measurement error, without sampling error, sample average will be equal to the population average. This is called central limit theorem. That has been taught to you yesterday. This is called central limit theorem. Sample average will be equal to the population average. All that required is you must take sufficient number of sample, calculate the average of the sample. If required, take multiple sample, calculate the average of the averages. Calculate the average of the averages. I'm sure average of the averages will be equal to the population characteristics. Average of the averages will be equal to the population characteristics. That is what you wanted to understand. Am I right? So, a sample is studied, sample characteristics is understood. Using the sample characteristics, population characteristics is predicted. The behavior of the sample is understood to understand the behavior of the population. The food inspector understood that samples are bad in terms of lead content. The food inspector understood that samples are not fit for consumption by human beings. And so population is also considered unfit for consumption by human beings. Can I now burn all the 38,000 Maggie packets? Is there anybody else have the guts to prove the statement against me? Or you have to accept my statement?
Accept the statement.
You will, because I have evidence of data. And my data is perfect. Why? Because the p-value generated from my data is less than 5%. P-value cannot go below 5% if the difference between the target value and the statistics you calculated is significant. Unless and until it is significant, p-value will not go below 5%. So the word significance is very important, right? So now the Maggie packet is burnt, banned, and 38,000 tons were burnt across 11 cement factories in the country. The decision was taken by the vice president of the company, Ficara. The company vice president himself decided to burn his own products, accepting the findings from the sample. Such a procedure is called hypothesis testing. This is a bad example. Sample helped you to conclude that your population is bad. If the sample helps you to conclude that your population is good, you can sell everything. Whether you want to sell it or you want to burn it, you require a hypothesis testing to be performed. And this hypothesis testing, the Maggie case, is an example of one sample t-test. It's an example of one sample t-test. You know why? The data used is continuous. The statistics use this average. The statistics use this average. Population is an unknown population. Population is an unknown population. Do you think all these things are taught to you yesterday? Saturated fat content is a continuous data. Am I right?
Yes, sir. 13 bottles.
Yes, sir. Yes, saturated fat content is a continuous data. You calculated average yesterday. You compared the average against the expected value, target value of 15. And your sample statistics were 16.6, but target was 15. And you concluded that 16.6 is significantly greater. And so the products are again considered bad in the yesterday's example. You called it as one sample t-test. This is almost the same. Continuous data. 100 sample. I calculated the average. And average lead content is found to be much higher than the prescribed level of lead content. If you are a food inspector like the Sanjay Singh from UP, who actually did the testing, population is unknown for you. If you are Sanjay Singh, population is unknown. When I say population unknown, you only know the target value. The actual data will not be available. Am I correct? You are a food inspector. You are also one of the consumer. You only know the target, but the actual data is not available. If actual data is not available, standard deviation will not be known to you. Only the target will be revealed to you. Yeah, food content is this much. That is written in the packet. You have to trust it. But the real data behind is not available to you. If real data is not available, you can't calculate average, you can't calculate standard deviation. Without knowing the average and standard deviation, you have to trust the company. That means the products of the company are now considered an unknown population for you. Do you understand why do I call the products of the company as unknown population? Because I don't have the access to the population data, population parameter, average and standard deviation. Importantly, if the standard deviation is not known, population is unknown. For Sanjay Singh, population is unknown. But for Ficara, population is known. Do you understand? Who is Ficara?
A question.
Ficara is the vice president in the company.
Sir, a question.
All the data within his company. Yes. Sir. Yes, Vivek, you can go ahead with your question.
Sir, FSAI, will it not be dictating what is the deviation permissible, sir? When they decide the limits, they will be allow some deviations also.
Yes, after the deviation only the guideline is given.
So in that case, allowed.
See, deviation is certain lead can be there, some content can be there. A small, maybe some PPM. In terms of PPM, it is given. Let's say 5 PPM is allowed. But how much is the lead content calculated in Maggie? You see here?
17.2 parts per million.
I'm not very sure about the exact permissible lead content. You can check the internet. If for discussion sake, let us say it is 5 ppm, 5 parts per million. Where is 5 ppm? Where is 17 ppm? Significantly higher, right?
Contribution.
Did not take any measures to control the lead content. They are least bothered about the health of the people and they are simply selling. But while getting the approval, they maintained it as per the standards, 5 ppm. But after 3-5 years, it is now 17. What happened? The process deteriorated. Do you remember I told you, in long term, any process will deteriorate?
Yes, sir.
And that has happened. That has been proved. And company is punished. 38,000 Maggie packets were burnt. For Sanjay Singh, the test is one sample T test. For Fikara, the test is one sample Z test. Why? For Sanjay Singh, population is unknown. But for Fikara, population is known. Suppose if I want to understand how the MBA students are from Wales University, I will take a sample, study, and based on the sample, I will comment about your MBA department. But for your MBA HOD, the population is known population. Am I correct? Your MBA HOD can actually get the information about each, every one of you and then come to a conclusion. But I will come to a conclusion only by referring to the sample. Suppose if I talk to some good students, I will think that, the students are great. The MBA students are great. But when I talk to some students who are really poor, what will happen to my conclusion? My conclusion will be bad. So T-test has certain limitation. It is less accurate. Why? It doesn't work with the real population parameter. Standard deviation is not known. Everything is picked up from the sample only. Sample standard deviation is used in the calculation. Sample standard deviation is used to calculate the Z score. We call it a T score. When sample standard deviation is used, we call it a T score. That is nothing but an approximate Z score. An approximate Z score is called T score. But if the population standard deviation is known, the Z score, what I'm going to get is accurate Z score. The test will be called Z test. Do you all now understand the difference between one sample Z test and one sample T test? I need an yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Your population should be known. Data must be continuous. The statistics used for the decision making should be average. If all these things are happening, your test is Z test.
Z-test.
Population is not known, but still data is continuous. Statistics referred is average. It is T-test. Since sample is used to conclude on the population, it is called one sample Z-test or one sample T-test. So what is hypothesis testing? It is a decision-making procedure. A claim about a population is tested for its trueness using a sample. What is the claim about the population? Maggie is saying that the lead content is under control. Lead content is under the prescribed level. If lead content is under the prescribed level, this is what everybody believes. But reality is not under the limit, right? So a statement about the population is tested, right? Decision-making procedure, a claim about the population is tested for its trueness. For example, you in the project mode, you did the brainstorming and all your experts are telling you, that reaction time affects the process yield. Or pouring temperature, the temperature of boiler affects the final result or the yield of it. So temperature is X factor. The yield is Y factor. Temperature is affecting the yield. So these are all the suggestions, suspect. All of them are claims. If you want to validate the claim, the tool to be used is hypothesis testing. If somebody is asking me, sir, how are the MBA students of Wales University? Now I will make a statement. What do you think I will say about all of you? Do you think I will say all the students are gems? All the students are no great? Or do you think I will say no, the students are bad? What do you think? Come on, yeah, what do you think? Do you think I will talk bad about all of you?
No, sir.
I won't. That I will be always trying to make a statement which is innocent. Am I right? I'll say that, sir, students are great, sir. You take any number of students. Because that doesn't require any further investigation. When I say all the students are fantastic, excellent, you know, skillful, and you must hire them, then you know, no proof is required. But when I have to say, oh, sir, don't go there, they will ask me then, why are you saying like that? Isn't it? That means when my innocent statement doesn't require proof. The statement of innocence is called null hypothesis. Statement of innocence is called null hypothesis. The statement of guiltiness is called alternate hypothesis. Understood? Yes or no? Mathematically, statement of equality is called a null hypothesis. Statement of inequality is called alternate hypothesis.
Got it, sir.
Right? And now you have the two team captains, Indian team captain and Pakistan team captains. There is going to be a match tomorrow. And there is going to be, you know, what do you call the tournament? A tournament is going to happen. Tell me which team will win, whether India will win or Pakistan will win.
India
will win. Since because you are saying India will win, can I give the trophy to India directly?
No, sir. No.
Then the statement what you are doing is, no, requires some investigation. Am I right? If you say India will win, that means India is better than Pakistan. That is what you are trying to say. When you say India is better than Pakistan, that is alternate hypothesis. Am I right?
Sir.
Suppose if you are a Pakistani, what you may say? Sir, Pakistan will win. Then what is your statement? Null hypothesis or alternate hypothesis?
Alternative.
Null.
Suppose you null want to make him. Yes, Vivek.
Sir, it will be null for him and for us it will be alternate.
Your voice was breaking. Suppose if you...
Sir, his... his, for him, it will be a null hypothesis. For us, it will be alternate.
No. Then, you know, situation will be very confusing. If you say for India, tsunami is good, and for America, tsunami is bad, are you giving justice? Tsunami is bad for everyone, isn't it? Always, statement of difference is alternate. Statement of no difference is null. Statement of equality is null. Statement of inequality is alternate. Statement of innocence is null. Statement of crime is alternate. You should not break all these rules. If you break the rules, there is no science, there is no MBA, there is no one. You can confuse everyone around you. Certain standards have to be maintained when we are talking. So this is the standard as far as the statistical hypothesis testing is concerned. So Pakistani think Pakistani will win. India think India will win. The moment you say either India will win or Pakistan will win, you are trying to say that one team is better than the other. If you say one team is better than the other, that is alternate. If I say both teams are equal in strength, that means anybody can win the match tomorrow. Right? Both teams have equal strength. What is that statement?
Null hypothesis.
Beautiful. Null hypothesis. The strength India has got is equal to the strength Pakistan has got. This is what ICC believes. This is what ICC believes. Isn't it? ICC always conducts a match. Conducting a match is nothing but doing an experimentation. India will play 20 overs, 120 balls. Pakistan will play 120 balls. Performance is absurd. Difference is noted. And based on the difference, decision is taken. This is nothing but an hypothesis testing. Every game played is an hypothesis testing. Whether you play cricket or you play chess or you play football, every single minute in our life we use hypothesis testing. I want to compare two people. That's an hypothesis testing. RK sir also training, I am also training. So we are asking you to give a score. You might give a score for me and give a different score for RK. There is a difference. Is this difference really true, or we are exactly equal? If there is a difference, that means you must reject your null. If no difference, you must accept your null. What is the null statement?
They both are equal.
If both of us are equally effective, that is null statement. Unless and until you see for yourself, you see the evidence, you will always say, sir, both are effective. But the moment you understand, sir, no, sir, one professor is doing better. Because you have experienced it, am I right? You have experienced it. Once when you experience it, you go with alternate. You want to experience to the extent that the error in your statement goes below 5%. If the error in your statement goes below 5%, what will happen to the p-value?
Decreases.
Goes below 5%. That is why we want you to go with the alternate statement only when p-value is less than 5%. P-value is an estimate of type 1 error. P-value is an estimate of type 1 error in your study. Type 1 error is also known as manufacturer's risk. It is also known as false positive. Manufacturing industry, they call it manufacturer's risk. Pharma and healthcare industry, they call it false positive. These are different language, different industry use. If you join as a medical representative in the pharma company, then you should know about type 1 error, which is false positive. Right? So we will see that. So null statement is nothing but everybody believes, no evidence is required. When I simply say, sir, all the students are good, no evidence required. But when I say, sir, two students are really problematic, then evidence is required. When I say two students are problematic, then it is alternate. When I say the students are great, no question asked. When I say you are healthy, it's a null hypothesis. When I say you are affected by corona, a lab test is required. Then it is alternate. Whenever experimentation is required, data is required, that is called argument, right? So null hypothesis is a statement of innocence. Null hypothesis is a statement of, what you call, no change. Null hypothesis is a statement of no difference. You can assume this if whenever you are not able to prove the alternate. Whenever you are not able to prove the alternate, please assume that null is true. For example, you are not able to do the diabetic study. You are not able to test your blood. You can consider yourself as non-diabetic. Am I right? Because you are not in any study. You don't have any evidence. So you simply think that, no, you are healthy. But when you do a lab study, if the sugar levels are found to be higher, now you will start believing on the alternate. They have become diabetic. You will start taking medicines. But till the lab study is conducted, do you think you will start taking medicines in advance?
No.
So, it is to be assumed if you cannot prove the alternate. So, what is alternate? Alternate is the statement of inequality, statement of, you know, impact. If you say the factor is making an impact, that is alternate. If you say the factor is not making an impact, that is null. This is how you are going to use hypothesis in our project. Factor making an impact means factor is critical. When I say factor is critical, what is it? Alternate hypothesis. When I say factor is not critical, it is called what?
Null hypothesis.
Right? And this alternate hypothesis is referred to as research hypothesis. Suppose tomorrow you join PhD after MBA. This hypothesis testing is going to be very, very helpful. That is why I always say For graduates, it is project execution methodology. For PhD scholars, it is research methodology. For working professionals, it is improvement methodology. It helps you at all level, whether you are a student or a professional or a leader, right? And for leaders, it is decision-making methodology. Now coming to the cooking oil problem, you already understood.